I am John Kaiser in Vancouver at the Metals Investor Forum on Saturday, January 20th. I am talking with Wade Hodges, CEO of Nevada Exploration Inc. Wade, welcome to Vancouver.
Glad to be here, John. Thank you.
Wade, almost 20 years ago, you left the big company fold, where you were involved with the discovery of tens of millions of gold ounces in Nevada, including the Twin Creeks project, which is still operating. You had an insight that what the EPA was doing, measuring the toxics in the groundwater surrounding proposed mining operations, was giving pathfinder clues that clearly made these deposits stand out. However, nobody wants a mercury or arsenic deposit, they want a gold deposit. And you saw some changes coming in detection limits for the laboratories that gave you the idea gold could be something that we measure in groundwater. And so you embarked on this journey in the wilderness to develop a method to collect groundwater in the basins of Nevada. It's all gravel covered with the idea of spotting the smell or detecting the smell of a major gold deposit of these Carlin type, which they had been found on the edges of the ranges, some of them in the ranges, and basically launch Nevada 2.0. What are the big major things that in this long journey you learned that have made you much more comfortable today that you have the tools needed to source these big targets?
John, I'm very impressed. You've covered it quite nicely. It's excellent. I was in the fortunately to be in the right place at the right time to look at the observations of the U.S. Geological Survey. Clearly, I could see from their reports that gold did exist in groundwater around these known deposits, very large, very substantial, and in an area that was completely covered, which is really where the potential of Nevada exists. Between the mountain ranges. For a whole host of reasons, Nevada is still, after 20 years, recognized as one of the highest concentration of multi-million ounce gold deposits of any place on the planet per unit area. And so 60% of that area is covered by gravel. And so it just makes imminent sense to me to apply the observations that we had at Twin Creeks to, is it possible to look at the chemistry of groundwater, specifically for gold, but all the other toxics, to identify our fingerprint of an area underneath the gravel. Well, 20 years now has gone by. We've solved many problems how to actually collect groundwater in the desert, developed two tools, two platforms that allow us to do that. One we call a geoprobe, the other one is a Scorpion drill rig, and they're small footprints, environmentally low impact, that allows us to cruise around the flat open areas between the mountain ranges to taking simple samples of gold water. And when we see gold in the groundwater, it's telling us from looking at a lot more than, it's about 5,500 to 6,000 samples now we've collected, you can see in that data set patterns that clearly come together and focus your interest in specific areas. And it's telling you that go figure, gold in groundwater around large deposits. Why do we have the same fingerprint in an area where we don't have a large ground deposit? The next step is to now drill. Drill down to bedrock to test this entire concept. Okay, so we've been able to do that successfully, and we've got the impression, I think, now in the investment community that sounds great, Wade, good idea, but you've got a general plume of some kind, but how do you target? How do you focus it down to a drill target? And what I want people to understand is currently people extrapolate the geology from the mountain ranges, structures, alteration, host rock, mineralization, out under the gravel cover. They get a target where things intersect, and then they begin drilling, poke and hope. And the results are such that there's been a decline in discoveries in spite of all this science and projections. What I want you to do is think in terms of the groundwater chemistry is now another filter that is going to be able to pick and select between these different targetings, different targets out under the cover. And so for my money, I would be willing to invest in the good concept, the good cartoon, the good projections that actually have gold in the groundwater as well.
So for most of this 20 years, you used something called a geoprobe, which effectively got you, allowed you to build a two-dimensional groundwater database, and you identified dozens of potential hotspots in Nevada. A couple of them you have drilled. One of them that caught Rob McEwen's attention was Grass Valley. You had a surprising anomaly with all the pathfinders streaking off to the southwest of where Cortez Hills, an absolutely amazing deposit, is located. But at the end of the day, you poked one hole at it, hoped, and your hopes were dashed, and McEwen dropped out. But that problem of having a two-dimensional anomaly and not quite knowing where it's coming from, where the source actually is, this focusing, prompted you guys to develop an alternative to seek how can we get a three-dimensional anomaly. And last year, you launched what you call the Scorpion rig, which is some sort of a customized RC rig, which you know, can get into bedrock somewhat, but it's not your traditional hole. And you collected a lot of samples in Kelly Creek Basin, and you have just published a news release with a 25-page technical presentation, which shows a lot more contextual detail than I've ever seen based on your past efforts with you know, gravity surveys and two-dimensional groundwater. Has this Scorpion rig, this collecting of 3D, made a huge difference? And how do you feel about what you're now seeing at this target, which is not far from the 5 million ounce Lone Tree deposit that's now mined out, and the global 8 million ounce Marigold project where SSR Mining, formerly Silver Standard, is mining low grade gold and looking for more?
Well, precisely. What you're seeing in the water chemistry and the results that you're talking about in the third dimension and being much more detailed, that is in fact the change. Before that, we'd seen gravity, geophysics. These are the normal tools that you use to project out undercover. And you leave the viewer kind of, well, okay, could be, don't quite understand. But what we have been able to do is take the two-dimensional data with the geoprobe, because we had that previously. And it's a wide space sampling grid, and we get one sample per drill spot at a nominal depth of 100 feet of groundwater. And we know that the groundwater exists in this alluvial stack of alternating clays and sand zones, so there's zones of poor, more and less permeability. And as you go down a hole, you want to be able to map that entire variability, high and low, high and low, high and low. And with one sample, you don't really get to see that, but you get enough of a sniff to justify coming back, and that drove the desire to look in the third dimension, to take in one spot, you can now take a sample repeatedly every 30 feet down the hole, down the hole. And that, and we did that by using an RC drill rig, but it's a smaller one. It's a small RC. It'll drill down to 500 feet, not 1,500 feet. It's not as big as some of the RC drilling machines that are out there now, because they were all designed to drill deep to explore targets at depth. What we're focused on is not so much getting samples of the alluvium and the bedrock. We want the water. To drill the water, you need uncontaminated water. Water that's not contaminated by drilling fluids, which is what the large RC rigs use to get deeper. They condition the hole. There's a lot of words that talk about building a wall cake, and it keeps the water and holds the material, the loose gravel, away from caving in on the hole. Well, what we need to do is find a way to drill through that without drilling fluids to be able to sample just the formation water. What we were able to do is to find that when you lower the drill pressure, okay, you're not blowing air into the formation. It's the way these operations work is air goes down the middle, and it's designed so that the air then takes the broken rocks off the bit and moves up the inside of a tube, the pipe. Well, at the face of the bit, the air can go into the formation and it'll blow it apart, which is why the solution has always been these layer cakes. Well, we've been able to do that. We've got a series of data that you can see now in the presentation on the website that you referenced that'll take the viewer 1, 2, 3 to be able to connect the steps. What we're now developing are things that look like, in fact, groundwater plumes. There's enough detail. It looks like a leaky gas tank. Mm-hmm. And the source of that leak is what the environmental community is trying to find. We're able to do that here in this case by looking where's the source of this gold, arsenic, antimony.
So I can see you're excited about Kelly Creek Basin. And one last question here and quick. Grass Valley is unfinished business, but you've wandered and sampled down the entire Grass Valley to the southern end. And your current focus is something you call South Grass Valley, where there has been some drilling in the outcrop nearby where nobody ever found anything. And yet you guys think there's something there. The Kelly Creek Basin's probably upper plate hosted mineralization. Here you think you may have lower plate. Where's that project standing today? I haven't heard anything for the past year about it.
Well, you're right, Grass Valley, we still have it. It's still active. And there was one hole drilled there. The idea is clearly not tested. And so that is still part of our active thought process and the place we're applying our tools. South Grass Valley, we decided to focus on after Kelly Creek Basin. And we're currently drilling right there, collecting additional groundwater samples using the GeoProbe, the Scorpion drill rig. We've had two shifts of work back in November. That data has now just come in. We've got a third batch of samples that we're just now sending in. The turnaround time is reduced to 2 weeks. And what we've seen so far is an improvement of the anomaly, of focusing, it's still there, one. The more detailed sampling has defined it and focused where we need to be, and the next step is to drill there as well. Now, we think it's really is exciting because, as you pointed out, we actually have lower plate rocks in outcrop, in a very short distance away from the golden groundwater anomaly. The thing that is so different is that we don't get any samples or gold in the groundwater around the area that's been drilled in outcrop. Go figure, there's no gold in the groundwater, the results are substantiated, there's no real resource in the gold, in the rock, but the host rocks are there, the structure is there, the rest of the elements, and so now we've got gold in groundwater, and I submit anybody else that had been in the area that had known that existed, they would have drilled the hole, and that's what we need to do.
It's unusual, a company, big data oriented, most companies get excited when the drill core comes up. You guys get excited waiting for all these bottles of water results to come back and you plot them up and all of a sudden it blossoms and you know you're in the game.
It's extremely exciting. It's like Christmas presents over and over and over. Every 15 days there's a new batch of news. We focus on it and we get excited and invariably we're seeing what it is we want to see. We're confirmed in our expectations.
I've been talking with Wade Hodges, CEO of Nevada Exploration Inc. in Vancouver at the Metals Investor Forum. Thank you, Wade.
Thank you, John.